Hello, my name is Christopher, and I have the pleasure of beginning this presentation on our work titled Proof of Learning, Definitions in Practice. Later you'll hear from my fellow co-authors, Mohammed, Henry, Anvith, and Natalie. What motivated our work was two major challenges in machine learning. The first is the challenge of machine learning intellectual property resolution, which asks the question, how can a model owner prove that they produced a model? This is an open and difficult challenge in ML that arises due to the popular model extraction attack. Given some publicly hosted model, an adversary employing this attack can reverse engineer a model by querying it. Here, an arbitrator may be needed to facilitate ownership resolution. The second challenge surrounds Byzantine workers in distributed and collaborative learning setups, which are of growing popularity in the ML community. Here, we see a central server with distributed workers across the bottom. We pondered what happened when Byzantine workers deviated from the designated collaborative protocol, and then asked ourselves, is there a way to verify computations made by distributed workers? There are three related works that address these issues or questions of ownership resolution and Byzantine workers. These are watermarking defenses and fingerprinting for the former, or verifiable computations for the latter. However, both watermarking and fingerprinting lead to unfavorable trade-offs between their success and the model utility, meaning that it can be difficult to employ these solutions while attaining similarly performant models. They also require training time modification, limiting their general applicability. Verifiable computations require inference time alterations, such as changes to architectures or restrictions on what operations can be used. These unfavorable side effects led us to the question, what if learners could create a verifiable proof of their efforts in training a model? If they could, they could provide these proofs to arbitrators to resolve ownership conflicts, or central servers could use them to verify if the delegated computation was performed correctly. As we will show, this is what a proof of learning provides. It is a permanent record of the entire training effort expended by the learner, not just the end result. It can be used in many ways, including aiding in temporal guarantees, like who learned the model or created the proof first. It is also naturally amenable to verification by an arbitrator, and is application agnostic. This means that a proof algorithm simultaneously tackles both ownership resolution and verified training computations. Finally, and tied back to the challenges with prior work, a proof can be boiled down to just a form of logging, which means that there are no changes to already complex training procedures, outside of adding those logs. Thus, there is also no trade-off between the proof success with model utility.
Hello, I'm Mohammed Yagini, and I will be presenting our main contribution to proof of learning. Let's start by an observation. Training a model is often an incremental process. Model weights are initialized from a random state W0 and updated as new data is provided to the model. These updates naturally form a chain, each link of which can be verified by an arbitrator who can perform the updates using gradient descent, for example, and verify that the resulting weights are close to the weights mentioned in the proof. So is it enough to only record the weight sequence? The answer is no, because weights are not enough to reproduce the updates. We also need data and auxiliary information, such as the learning rate used to make the update. Therefore, these pieces of information should also appear in the proof. We define proof of learning, or PLL, as the tuple WIHA, where W is the sequence of model weights, I is the set of data indices used to learn the weights, and A is the auxiliary information that is necessary for training. Note that this is enough for producing and verifying a proof for a model that is trained on a publicly available dataset. If the training data is private, however, we require that the prover also provides signatures of the data points used in the training as well. So we saw that the proof creation is equivalent to recording the chain of updates. However, if all the links are recorded in the proof, the size of the proof would become prohibitively large. So instead, the prover can record the weights only every k steps and leave them out everywhere else. So P0 is recorded, then the weightless proof P1, then P2 until pk, where the full proof is again recorded. From here on, we simplify our diagrams by replacing all the P-tildes with this arrow. Finally, this is done for every epoch of the training.
Hi, I'm Hengrui. Let me start to discuss the proposed verification mechanism of the proof of learnings. First, let's focus on the initial state of the proof, P0. This state should contain the initialization parameters of the trained model. But what if the adversary uses a stolen model at the initial state? We know it is almost impossible for just an initialized model to have great performance, but we need to prove it. The tool we use here is a statistical test named KS test, which tests if a set of values sampled from a certain distribution. How effective is it? We plot the p-value of KS test with respect to the number of training steps on the parameters of a ResNet 20 model trained on CIFAR-10. Here, the average and mean are taken across different layers of the network. In other words, the p-value represents how likely a certain layer is newly initialized. Let's zoom in a little bit. As shown in the lower left corner, with less than 10 gradient steps, the p-value goes under 0.01. The validation accuracy of the model at this moment is only slightly above 10%, so we can expect an even lower p-value if an adversary uses the stolen model at the initial state. The method can effectively prevent the adversary using an arbitrary initialization. Now the initial state is verified, we will continue to verify the other states. We use what we call the stepwise verification for this part. In high level, we verify the proof by reproducing the training and see if we get the same final model. I will describe this in details and motivate why it is correct and also necessary. Gradient descent is Markov. As shown in the equation, to perform a gradient descent, only the previous set of model parameters is needed. Most operations from frequently used machine learning libraries, such as TensorFlow and PyTorch, are non-deterministic, so there is some randomness at each step of gradient descent, denoted by that in the equation, and this randomness is IID distributed during training. Since entropy is a measure of randomness, we can see that the total entropy increases linearly with respect to number of training steps, and the entropy of every single gradient descent is h of set 0. For detailed derivation, please see the paper. If we train a model and try to reproduce the training process to verify the proof, that's a naive approach where we start from the same initial state and use the data in the same order. It is still almost impossible to reproduce the same sequence of model parameters because entropy accumulates and is unbounded. Therefore, we introduce stepwise verification. For every step, we check if the reproduced model is close to the corresponding model state in the proof. If so, we load the model state from the proof and try to reproduce the next state based on this state, and so on. By doing so, we only need to deal with the entropy for one single step. Now let's numerically verify this. In this table, the values are distances between two sets of model parameters. They're normalized to the range between 0 and 1, by the distance between two completely unrelated models. We use k to represent the checkpointing interval, which is defined to be how frequent we start model parameters. The leftmost column is what would happen if we take the naive approach. As you can see, due to the accumulated entropy, the resulted model has near one distance to the original model. In other words, it is impossible to verify the proof. In the middle column is the result of stepwise verification, and we set k equal to 1. Since the randomness is only from one step, the distance is close to 0, meaning the verification is straightforward. Detailed impact of values of k is discussed in the paper. You may wonder what if we use deterministic operation. However, that only restricts randomness coming from the backend software like CUDNN. Other noise sources such as hardware are hard to control. The average distance is around 0.5. This is better than the naive approach, but still incurs some difficulties at verification.
You've demonstrated the correctness of stepwise verification, but it has a drawback. Verifying the complete proof can be as expensive as retraining the old model. Our intuition is that having large valid updates would be akin to having a large learning rate and gradient set, which is likely to cause oscillation and other instabilities in training. We therefore hypothesize that valid updates are typically small in magnitude, and that we can save computational costs by only verifying the largest updates. But let's see this process in more detail. Here, we show the proof sequence for the first epoch that runs from P0 to P5k. We use the length of the arrows to demonstrate the distance between the initial and the final stages of each update. We sort all the updates by their distances and select the two largest updates to verify and discard the rest.
We will talk about what the adversary may do in response to the proposed mechanism. The prover has a legitimate proof that could pass verification. The threat is that an adversary wants to pass verification by creating a proof that requires less computational power than training the model. We call this as spoofing. It is possible because only part of the proof is verified, and the adversary may have access to some stolen model parameters. This is more information than when the prover started to train the model. The spoofing could be either honest or dishonest. In the honest case, the adversary tries to create a fully valid proof where every single step could pass a verification. However, such methods usually lead to computational costs that are equally or even more expensive than training the model, which goes against the adversary's failing. To evade this cost, the adversary may want to be dishonest and create a partially invalid proof. This means the adversary tries to take advantage that not all steps are verified and hide the invalid parts of the proof, hoping that they won't be noticed. Next, I'm going to give an example of a dishonest spoofing strategy. We assume the adversary is aware that not the entire proof is verified. The Bible has initialization verification, so the words we want to train from initialization. But this is only for a small number of steps, since the words we want to save computational cost. This results in a valid proof. Then the words we append the stolen model to the end and hope this single invalid step in the proof won't be noticed. This won't work because we would verify the top q largest steps, and the concatenated step is likely to be the largest since the stolen model does not have any connection to the model parameters in the valid proof. As shown in these two figures plotted for CFR10 and CFR100 respectively, no matter how long the adversary has trained the model before concatenation, as shown on the x-axis, the gap at the concatenation, which is plotted at the y-axis, is almost always above 1. This means that the distance between the last model in the valid proof and the stolen model is similar to the distance between any two unrelated models.
A natural question when looking at the iterative nature of a proof is whether it might be possible to trace back the steps of a proof obtaining an honest spoof, and whether this might give the adversary some sort of advantage. But how would someone do this? Well, looking at the formula for SGD and rearranging the terms, we see we could actually solve for the previous weights given the current weights at a particular step by root solving this new equation. And so we can iteratively trace back a possible training sequence. But as we'll explain, this isn't a viable spoof. We can understand why this won't work, theoretically, in terms of our entropy growth analysis. For the regular training update rule, we see all the terms are deterministic except for the hardware randomness, which is in fact independent of the training step. So our entropy growth is constant over training. However, with our inverse gradient update equation, we get a slightly different equation for entropy growth. In particular, we still have the same hardware randomness term from training, and so we see our entropy will grow at least as much as when training. But as there could be several solutions to our root-solving problem, that is, there could be more than one path leading to the current weights, each of which our root-solving may return with non-zero probability, we have an extra term capturing this new random variable. This is all to say that with inverse gradient method, we expect to face at least as much randomness as training, which was already quite random. And as inverse training depends on root solving, which is sensitive to initializations, we expect to have a large verification error that wouldn't pass verification. We see this experimentally. Recall our verification error when creating an honest proof was more or less zero across the board. However, with inverse gradient method, we see a significant jump in these, at least 10 times in each metric, which is enough that they wouldn't pass any reasonable verification. So our experiments support our previous analysis that the inverse gradient method isn't a viable spoof.
Now we'll go over the overhead involved in our verification procedure. Here, we want a proof that is quickly verifiable in most cases and requires somewhat small storage. We'll start with the computational overhead involved in verifying a proof of learning from the prover. First, we'll go over some of the terms involved in the final cost. Recall from before that we use k to represent the number of training steps between recording the weights in the proof. We will use c to denote the computational cost of one forward and backward pass for backpropagation, and q is the number of checks, or the number of largest updates we need to verify. So we have the verification cost as polynomial in C, Q, and K. We now explore the storage overhead. The storage overhead involves K again, and we denote size P, the storage cost of the proof for a single step, E, the number of epochs, and S, the number of mini batches or steps per epoch. Then we have that the verification storage cost is O of size P, E, S over K, where size P is the storage for one loop, and ES over K is the number of loops in verification. So finally, we'll discuss some limitations of our proposed proof procedure and future directions to explore. We showed in the previous two slides the storage and computational costs of the verification procedure. So currently, the proposed verification method takes advantage of frequently stored checkpoints to verify the proof, but this leads to more cost on storage because size P will include at least the storage of the full model weights. Additionally, the verification is done by partially retraining the model, which in the worst case, when k is equal to 1, leads to verification being as costly as learning. So this means it's important to keep values of k as large as possible, but choosing large values of k is currently limited by the fact that increasing k also increases the verification error due to randomness in training DNNs. This is the primary source of error in correct verification, so identification and control of noise would be a good next step to boosting probability of success. Overall, reducing the verification cost and controlling noise would allow for support of longer and chained proofs and greater applicability. Finally, we discussed model extraction and faulty workers in delegation of computation scenarios as potential threats that we address. Since the concept of proof of learning and deep learning is very new, it's worth investigating other spoofing strategies that are more efficient and exploring different scenarios in which the proposed method could be used. So thank you so much for listening to our presentation on proof of learning, and please let us know if you have any questions.